First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for having accepted the topic of my paper in the conference. And, well, I will start. In his 1969 film, La Voix Lactée, Louis Buñuel depicts the followers of Priscillian, Bishop of Avila, gathered together in a wood at night while chanting in prayer, Cantare volo, saltate cuncti. I want to sing, everybody dance. These words are the Latin translation of a hymn from the Acta Ioannis, a Greek text which has been dated to between the mid-second and late third century, where Christ sings and dances during the Last Supper, while the apostles form a circle around him and accompany him by responding chorally. Eusebius of Caesarea classes the text as a non-divine scripture, and the Second Council of Nicaea in 787 judged it to be apocryphal and damned. Augustine recounts that the text was used by the Priscillianists and mentions certain passages of the hymn in a letter to Cerezius before condemning it. This led to the common opinion in historiography that the Priscillianists performed ritual dances, although we cannot know for sure whether this was true. Even Buñuel seems to focus on the lascivious and libidinous aspects of the community, features that have always been associated with chorutic performances, though he does not actually make them dance. Nevertheless, for the fathers of the church, there was nothing intrinsically wrong or lascivious about dancing per se. Indeed, when he refers to the hymn used by the Priscillianists, Augustine's disapproval seems to be directed more at the close similarity of the text to the Gnostic docetism and its darkness than at the blasphemous nature of Christ supposedly dancing. It could therefore be claimed that the most negative characteristic of the text was the fact that it was used by a group of Christians who were considered heretics. During the course of my research on the Christian perception of chorutic gesture, I have been able to ascertain that a certain type of dancing was often used by the fathers of the church to provide a more effective definition of religious alterity, whether pagan, Jewish, or heretical. The results of this cultural construction can also be seen at a local level in certain testimonies regarding the Iberian Peninsula. Before coming to this, though, we need to make some more general considerations. The underlying theory of my work is that by regulating dancing, Christian intellectuals became spokesmen for an anthropology of gesture which, on one end, demonized all forms of performative dancing and, on the other hand, encouraged men to become the perfect imitators of an angelic choreia in the Platonic framework. This choreia was supposed to guide the behavioral movement and schemata of people's bodies. However, it did not only characterize one presumed ideal city, but also had to be realized in life on earth, the anticipatory mirror image of the heavenly city. Choreia is generally translated in modern languages as dance, in particular choral dancing. However, this translation does not really reflect the meaning that the term held in the ancient Greek world, which persisted even after the spread of Christianity. For example, processional movement also belongs to the lexicon of the concept of choreia, as well as the Latin chorus. The concept of choreia needs to be seen as the expression of the amalgamation of many musically coordinated and harmonized actions. Furthermore, in ancient Greece, the term musike expressed more than the current connotation of the word music. It was always a combination of words, melody, and choreutic gesture. For Plato, choreia was an instrument of paideia, which refers not only to scholastic and or physical education, but to the entire way of life. According to his thinking, moral and civic virtues could be acquired by learning to dance in the right way. Learning to execute the appropriate constitutive schemata for the relevant role in society. The whole civic system would be affected by the absence of this role, as it would also cast doubt on everyone else's roles. The inclusion of legislation about musical activity in Plato's laws shows the degree of power that he thought choral singing and dancing had as an agency of social control for the transmission and maintenance of the right feelings among citizens. The Greek term nomos, law, also indicates melody and musical mode. And nomoi were called the first melodic repertoires because it was essential to remain within the established confines of intonation. In this way, just as nomos, in the sense of law, is at the basis of social order, it is by following the musical nomos that the collective choreia should guide the social body harmoniously. The term choreia, therefore, indicates the combined actions of singing and dancing. According to Plato, the link between the two derives from the rhythm and movement of the body. In choral and chorutic performances, just as in social life, voice and body must move in a harmonious way, individually, collectively, and in relation to their performance space. Only those who are trained to follow this harmony can live in the Platonic city. He who cannot dance is described as achoreutos and is excluded from the ideal city, for he will not be able to socialize with the other citizens or move in harmony with the rest of the civic choreia. The choreia, therefore, plays a fundamental civic role in Plato's work, to the point where failure to move one's body in harmony with others is seen as immoral and depraved. As we know that Christian authors in the early centuries were particularly steeped in Platonic culture, I am firmly convinced that when someone like Basil of Caesarea invited Christians to imitate the choreia of angels on earth, he attributed the same Platonic value to the term. As Christian society had to aspire to this musical harmony, frenetic dances were prohibited because they were associated with dancing by demons and non-Christians. It is therefore unsurprising that John Chrysostom stated in one of his homilies that Jews danced barefoot in the square, bringing together camp dancing choruses and the pack of horse, and dragging the theater along with all its actors into their place of worship, because in his eyes there was no difference between the theater and the synagogue. The Christian intellectual aversion to dancing emerges above all in texts of a homiletic nature, namely those that had the precise aim of training and educating the faithful. The reasons for this aversion also included the sometimes unintentional construction of a religious otherness that expressed the need to develop a Christian religious identity. They immediately felt compelled to distance themselves from certain practices that had to be rejected, including customs attributed to pagans, Jews, and heretics, collectively perceived as a single major threat. Whether they did so consciously or not, the fathers of the church might have been conveying to the Societas Christiana the same values that Plato wanted in his ideal city. Indeed, Plato did not allow all forms of dancing in his state. For example, the Bacchic dances of nymphs and satyrs were excluded. In practice, there was no place for frenetic dances that made individuals lose their self-control, thereby interrupting the harmony of the civic choreia. This idea of always maintaining self-control and self-awareness is a vitally important concept throughout Christian culture. Frenetic gestures were not allowed in Plato's ideal city or in the Civitas Christiana, as they were a symptom of loss of self-discipline. With regard to ancient perspectives on dancing, I find that late antique and medieval Christianity was most significantly influenced by the confluence of views about the practice held in the Greek and Roman traditions, especially in the early imperial period. There was a somewhat ambiguous idea of the profession of actor and dancer in Rome that differed considerably from the Greek concept. Although the Romans were keen theatre goers, actors and dancers were included in the category of infames in Roman law. Infamia entailed the loss of political rights and the restriction of civil rights. Infamia was an ethical and social stigma expressing the disapproval of the dominant part of the civic body. The marginal status of infames in the Roman world was due to the act of prodire in scenam, or performing on stage. We know that this feature remained intact in the reasoning of most Christian authors. For example, Augustine praises the ancient Roman constitution for having assigned the lowest social ranking to actors and distinguishing them from respectable people. His words also show the fear of contamination that we often find in Christian polemics against performance and dancing. When speaking out against the Donatist ritual, for instance, he mentions Pestilentia Saltatorum, the pestilence of dancers, at the basilica dedicated to the martyr Cyprian. When Christians accused pagans of idolatry for celebrating feasts in honor of demons, they also accused them of holding ridiculous celebrations, and the figure of the dancer, actor, was held up as non-human and ferine because of ambiguity of the mask worn and his characteristic depraved gesturing, almost as if possessed. The fact that the church hierarchy and councils in late antiquity and the early Middle Ages and beyond frequently spoke out against dancing and cantica turpia, depraved singing, shows the level of importance attributed to controlling these phenomena. Now, taking some conciliar texts as my starting point, I will move the focus of my analysis to the Iberian Peninsula. The Council of Braga in 572 prohibits ballationes ante ecclesiam sanctorum. In the same way, the Council of Toledo in 589 bans ballimatie during festivities dedicated to the saints and defines them as irreligious. In order to avoid the frequent mistake of treating these displays as mere continuations of pagan practices, it is useful to concentrate on the terms used to refer to chorutic gestures in these contexts. To the extent that the terms ballationes and ballimatie are direct precursors of the modern Spanish verb bailar, it seems plausible to claim that they were already used at that time to indicate practices associated with the people, or as the text of the Council of Toledo specifies, with the vulgus. However, the Greek verb ballo, from which these terms derived, was associated with the actions of throwing and hurling rather than the harmonious Platonic notion of choreia, which the fathers of the church reworked and encouraged people to imitate. These were, therefore, terms which immediately had an extremely strong gestural connotation, which labeled them with negative traits pertaining to the realm of violence, insults, and hubris. Indeed, all of these characteristics had already been rejected by pagan intellectuals. It was therefore these gestural forms which were banned by conciliar norms and not choreutic practice per se, which had even been accepted by Ambrose of Milan in the Davidic form of an Onesta Saltatio. The negative connotation embodied by the terms derived from ballo is closely linked to noise, clamor, and raucous frenzy. Isidore of Seville makes the same connection with the action of ballematia by outlining the etymology of cymbals, quia cum ballematia simul percutiuntur, cumen in Greci dicunt sun balla. The association with pagans, and indeed heretics or Jews, is merely a secondary detail, perhaps a way to make this practice even more negative. However, the association with specific pagan rituals is clear in cases such as another passage by Isidore, where he rages against dancing during the celebration of the calends of January. Here too, it is not dancing that is rejected by the reason for dancing, which takes on a negative connotation because its main aim is idolatry. It is therefore idolatry that is rejected and refuted rather than dancing. At this point, we come to the source that provided the title of my paper, Spumansque ore linfatico baccabundus. This text is extremely interesting because it seems to provide many insights regarding the acceptance, rejection, and above all, the conceptual reworking of ancient religious and cultural motifs in the Iberian Christian framework. The text in question is a chapter of the Ordo Querimonie by Valerio of Bierzo, written in the second half of the 7th century. The ascetic monk describes one of the pseudo-sacerdotes, the false presbyters, who are also documented by Isidore. The terms used to define these figures are extremely interesting also in conciliar norms that always underline their ignorantia, which should not only be seen as lack of education, but the opposite of the concept of biblical wisdom, which is defined in relation to conduct in life, where the ignorant are placed on the same level as the impious and the insane. The incipiens is comparable to the Platonic apaideutos, which specifically refers to he who did not move in harmony with the rest of the civic choreia, namely the achoreutos. I think that Valerio's text should also be read in this light, as the output of an aristocratic intellectual who had access to a myriad of classical and patristic references that he used to define the controversial figure of a pseudo-sacerdos as absolute evil and the devil in person. Valerio does this by placing particular emphasis on the gestures that are directly related to physical appearance, namely schemata, which were also one of the most immediate means to define alterity in the ancient world. Ironically enough, The name of the man in question was Justus, which means right, but in Valerio's eyes he was totally wrong. Indeed, Valerio defines him as an equissimus vir and completely opposes his ordination as a presbyter. For Valerio, Justus is the devil in disguise, and the entire passage offers a rich array of references that include the world of theatre, an aspect which immediately brings us back to paganism and the late anti-Christian polemic against performance, which was based around the issue of duplicity, falsity, and therefore deceit. Valerio provides a physical description of Justus. The pseudo-sacerdos is literally a horrid little black man, or, to be precise, he has the colore barbarica nationis etiopum, which, without bringing up The Life of Anthony by Athanasius, which was certainly on Valerio's reading list, was a constituent element of the demonic imaginary in his milieu, so much so that Isidore also defined Ethiopians as monstruosa specie horribiles. The image that Valerio provides of Justus is of an illiterate and uncultured individual, just like the Platonic Apaidotos, which is directly related to his repugnant physical appearance. Justus is accustomed to lust, scurrility, shouting, and an agitated voice, all unacceptable characteristics in anyone who considers himself Christian. John Chrysostom had already denounced empty and meaningless speech in church, defining it as boe, like the cry of animals, clamor, musical racket, and even the ritual shrinking of the bacchi. With regard to this latter crucial aspect, Justus is also seen to be a keen lyre player, using the instrument to perform cantilenas lascivas. No one in the antique world would ever have associated the lyre with the Bacchic realm, which was typically tumultuous, disorderly, and chaotic. The instrument always suggested noble thinking and behavior, but it is clear in this instance that there was a reworking of ancient motifs that were no longer understood even by an intellectual like Valerio. For his part, Isidore seems to limit himself to associating the lyre with the pagan figures of Mercury and Orpheus. It is therefore not so important to establish exactly which instrument Valerio is referring to, as to highlight the reworking and attribution of the new meaning to an antique pagan motif in a now Christianized context. This context did not condemn this instrument or indeed music per se, but associated it with a generally non-Christian milieu. The clearly negative references to the ancient theatrical world in Valerio's text are highlighted by the use of terms like hypocrisis and simulatio. The most negative thing is Justus's simulation of the habitus, simulatum habitum. In Valerio's monastic culture, this term was loaded with meanings directly connected with bodily attitudes and gestural schemata, as it concerns ways of being and behaving related to morality. The Greek term schema defined the monastic habit, thereby connoting the perfect Christian. In Valerio's cultural and religious heritage, there is no worse characteristic than pretending to be able to wear the habitus, which is not simply an external garment, but most importantly represents the internal predisposition of a good Christian. Justus's unsuitability to wear the habitus is directly related to his frenetic gestures. Eustace dances, or rather performs the eubristic balli matie previously forbidden by the councils. Valerio is thus referring to this type of frenetic gesture, and indeed Eustace is described as accustomed to drunkenness and therefore has the lack of self-awareness typical of an individual that the monk ultimately defined as baccabundus, with the full Dionysian connotation of the term, which to con demonic overtones in the Christian context. Just as Dionysus was associated with the realm of alterity in ancient Greek mythology due to his oriental origins and the connotation of possession, Valerius Baccabundus is an invader, someone who abruptly intervenes to interrupt the harmony of the civic choreia. The Christian choreia is therefore the result of the patristic conceptual reworking of an ancient Platonic model. The thinking of Valerio of Bierzo, Isidore of Seville, and the authors of the Iberian conciliar texts that I have presented is both the result of and the further step in the implementation of this theoretical processing. This was a cognitive instrument and a control device which, by rejecting certain models and certain ancient practices and reworking others, aimed to make the Civitas Christiana become the anticipatory mirror of the heavenly city, which did not allow balli matie by baccabundi individuals, but only the harmonious dancing characteristic of the angelic choreia. Thank you for your attention.